Hey everybody, and welcome to Growth Insights number 18. A lot of trend spotting tools, design tools, and psychographics this week. As always, if the video goes too fast, and it usually does, you can download all of the resources at this URL or in the first link in the description below. We're gonna kick off with our new video, YouTube Bites, where we've crowdsourced our community's most impactful YouTube videos. They cover psychology, business, art design, personal growth, you name it. Hope you like it, I'm pretty sure you will. Okay, let's continue with this little gem. I think this is actually my favorite from the past month. Ferdinand shared meetglimpse.com, where you can track topics across the internet to identify growing trends before they're on everybody else's radar. It essentially gives you a cutting edge. What's great is you can sort by industry, company, topic, or styles. And it combines data from Amazon, Google, YouTube, Twitter, Reddit, and other sources. You get 3 reports for free on the free account, so you have to sign up to get your first 2 reports and then reply to their email to get an extra 1. So I discovered some really interesting stuff. Apparently canned wine is on the rise. TikTok is a growing online platform that apparently has more monthly active users than Twitter or LinkedIn. Water flossers are growing in interest, and so is ayahuasca. Also discovered Castbox, which is a podcasting platform that seems to be growing really, really fast. Once again, check it out. I'm pretty sure you'll love this one. Still on trends, thanks to Julia for sharing this one. Facebook IQ offers insights, studies, and research using people, advertising, and industry trends coming from Facebook, Instagram, Messenger, and other platforms. Let's look at an example. This 2019 Topics and Trends report is sort of a gold mine. It covers trends around beauty and fashion, commerce, entertainment, food and drink, mind and body, science and technology, travel and leisure. In it, I discovered the wonderful world of K-beauty, which is Korean beauty, and it's on the rise. I found out that eco products were growing, and that we've apparently entered the world of bread 2.0. It's really interesting to see some of the overlaps with the previous tool I shared, which was Glimpse. More on trends, thanks to Stefan for sharing this one. Google also uses its Google Trends engine to display shopping insights. So you basically type in a product or a brand to see trends going up or down specifically for that product or brand. And what's great is you can filter results by holidays to see when shopping sprees are hitting the web. It's only US data, but it's still amazing to have this information at the tip of your fingers. I love the internet. Okay, we're still on tools to discover trends. Let's jump into product and marketing trends now. Thanks to Luke for sharing this one. The trending section of sparktoro.com allows you to see what the marketing world is chatting about. It's like Hacker News, but for marketing. Good quality articles, unlike some other similar platforms that have suffered from their success. And here's some of the gems that we found. Okay, more trends tools. Here's a beautiful find from Katarina. It's a cool stats tool that shows you search engine market share, social media share, browser share, per country, and per device. It's really good, for example, if you're going international. Some of the numbers don't always look totally correct. Also, we're missing Snapchat and some other social media channels, but it's still good to get an idea. So just type in a country and which segmentation you're interested in. And for example, I had no idea that Twitter was actually bigger than Facebook in Japan. Oh, by the way, speaking of Twitter, thanks to Jean for sharing this one. It's called twitwipe.com. Maybe you've had a change of heart, or your boss started following you on Twitter, or you're tired of Twitter overall. Whatever the reason, Twitwipe deletes all of your tweets in one go, easily and for free. But be careful, there's no turning back. Okay, still on trends, it's important to think about the future a little bit. Now, we don't usually dive into really long-term future trends because most of the time they tend to be incorrect. I think we've read Black Swan way too many times to trust humans to predict the unpredictable. But Kevin Kelly tends to read signals really well, and he just tends to be right. In this amazing Wired piece, he explains that the social network of the future will be AR-based. It's coined as the mirror world, and this world is a place where virtual places overlay actual places. Kelly says that whoever dominates this third grand platform will become amongst the wealthiest and most powerful people and companies in history, just like those who now dominate the first 2 platforms that we have. He suggests that Pokemon Go might have been a hint of what it will be. And here's a beautiful video with a dystopian vision of what this world might look like. Kind of scary, kind of creepy, check it out. Kelly argues that this mirror world is inevitable, but for now the technology and the adoption isn't ready yet. Now, some have argued that the greatest social virtual platform of 2018 was actually Fortnite, the video game. Oh, by the way, fun fact, did you know that the founder of Fortnite is one of the biggest landowners in South Carolina? He buys up acres of land just to protect wildlife there. But one might ask, what's next after Fortnite? Thanks to Peter for sharing this tweet, Neil Sabrat would argue that it's Apex Legends, which hit 10 million players in just 3 days. So Minecraft came along, grew, and then started to fall. Fortnite grew like crazy and seems to be showing signs of falling, and Apex Legends might be the next thing. And if you don't know what I'm talking about with all these names, get with the program. Okay, let's move away from social platforms and let's dive into some tools. This website's pretty amazing. This website shows AI-generated faces of people who don't exist. Just reload the page for a new face every time. Thanks to David for explaining that there's a paper about it. They use neural networks trained with millions of faces to generate them. They're called generative adversarial networks. You probably remember deepfakes from last year where they use them to swap faces on videos, which led to good memes of putting Nicolas Cage's faces in every movie. I don't know what the exact applications of this are, but it's kind of cool. If you're really into gray hat marketing, you could use this to create fake profiles on social networks, and I'm not saying that you should, or you can just play around with it to find weird faces like this person with a strange bulge. Oh, and by the way, thanks to Koss for sharing another little bit of AI. Remove.bg's AI tool is trained to detect persons as a foreground and everything else as background. It's not 100% perfect, but it's pretty slick and free for personal use. And still on the subject of AI, but AI that generates content this time, OpenAI just released a memo that they built an AI text generator, but they felt that it was too dangerous to release to the public. Specifically, when asked to reply to the prompt, "Recycling is good for the world," this is what they came up with. So first, it's scary because it passes the Turing test. You can't tell that it's been written by a bot. And second of all, look at the answer. "Recycling is not good for the world. It's bad for the environment. It's bad for our health, and it's bad for our economy." It's interesting to see an organization like OpenAI put ethical limits to what they agree to release. Because this AI seems like it had a really strange personality. And how do you train for personality? Speaking of personality, fantastic share from Udit. Remember Kaczynski and Mats, which we talked about a few episodes ago, and their Facebook-led psychological test? Well, it was down for a while, and now it's back, so you can play around with it. What you do is you link your Facebook data to it, if it's still relevant, and if you're not scared to share that information. You can also link your Twitter data directly, and you see how machine learning uses your behavior on social platforms to guess some of your personality traits. What's also great is they actually show you some of the factors that can influence whether you look like a trait or not. Still on the subject of personality and psychographic targeting, here's Sandra Matt's new company, DataScene. They offer personality-based targeting based on the big five known as the Ocean Model. How open you are, how conscientious you are, how much of an extrovert you are, how agreeable you are, and how neurotic you are. They've been stacking up data to predict how people with different personalities like to communicate, what images they like, which fonts they prefer, which colors and design they like in their emails, to essentially allow you to adapt a user interface and messaging to different personalities. It's still in beta version, but we've requested a demo, and we'll let you know how it goes. And if this seems too far-fetched for now, you can still apply personalization with much easier tools. This is a powerful new functionality from Instapage. We've talked about the powerful tactic of symmetric messaging in the past. Instapage has created a similar functionality called Add to Page. It's kind of new, so you'll have to request a demo, but it's sort of a low-hanging fruit way of delivering one-to-one personalization from your campaigns to your landing pages, and hence, increasing conversions. Okay, still on the subject of UX and landing page optimization, here's a fantastic share from Sophie. Sophie shared the mobile page test section of Mobile Moxie. It allows you to preview how web pages look on different mobile devices. There's tons of screens and devices to choose from. It's great for cross-device testing, and the best part, it's free. You can use it for free 10 times per day, then you'll need to pay, and we would suggest you pay if you love it, or if you're really sneaky, just use a VPN. Still on the subject of UX and optimizing web pages, if you have a complicated pricing model, or if you're currently focusing on optimizing the bottom of your funnel, the moment where people actually buy, you might need a calculator to allow customers to calculate what the actual cost of your product is adapted to their situation. This tool has some really nice templates of calculators, letting users calculate the value of your products in a few clicks. Check out the templates. This one was interesting for mortgages. There's one for sunglasses and a bunch more. Check it out. Still about payment and pricing pages, here's a really nice share from Julia. It's called Samcart, and it's basically an off-the-shelf best practice payment page. We're surprised at how little people experiment with pricing strategies or even with pricing pages. Now, Samcart won't test your pricing strategy, but it does offer integrated features like offer bumps, one-click upsells, A/B testing, and even payment plans. The pricing is quite moderate. It starts at $99 per month with 18 templates. And if anything, even if you don't pay and use the tool, it might give you some great low-hanging fruit ideas on how to increase those shopping baskets. Okay, still on the subject of conversion-centric design, we've shared tons of logo makers in the past. MyBrandNewLogo.com is a great way to create a fast logo if you want to prototype a new product, if you're running experiments, if you don't want to go on brand, or if you're trying to experiment with a new small identity. Oh, here's a cool one, speaking of design and UI. What's the biggest online shopping platform in the Western world? It's Amazon. Jean also shared this one. It's a pretty amazing tool that removes everything annoying about Amazon, and it lets you focus solely on the product and the product information. It's called Amazon Lite, and it allows for a Zen Amazon shopping experience. Speaking of Amazon, if you want to understand more about the tentacular power of the company, be sure to read this article shared by Peter, in which you'll discover or rediscover that Amazon is an e-commerce platform, a cloud computing provider, a TV producer, a fashion designer, a wind farm backer, and organizer of crowdsourced micro labor. important company, important to know more about it. Now, since we're on the subject of fast-growing companies and ginormous startups, we already mentioned blitzscaling in our video Book Bites, where we dive into each book and explain it in one sentence. Oh, by the way, if you love physical books, you're gonna love this tool shared by Ferdinand. It's called keypassages.showalsoft.ltd, and it's really cool. You scan the barcode of your book, you take a picture of a note inside the book, something that you want to keep, and it turns it into text. Pretty cool, check it out. But now back to what I was talking about, back to blitzscaling. So blitzscaling is the notion of hyper-fast scaling, privileging speed over efficiency. We read an interesting article from Tim O'Reilly that goes a little bit against the notion of blitzscaling. Blitzscaling argues that some of the world's most powerful companies in the US and in China, Uber, Airbnb, Facebook, Baidu, WeChat, Amazon, Slack, have adopted a blitzscaling strategy defended by network effects. But Tim O'Reilly points out that the valuation of these companies are preposterous. Lyft, for example, is shooting for a valuation between $15 and $30 billion, and Uber was valued at an astonishing $120 billion. Neither company is profitable yet, but hopes that profit will eventually follow in the future justify these valuations. Now, what's even more interesting is that O'Reilly says that the cash needed for blitzscaling is subsidizing products that would probably have been better if there had been more competition. Because these companies were given so much cash, they destroyed the competition and they didn't allow for organic product development based on user needs. O'Reilly prefers profitable companies, often bootstrap companies like MailChimp or Basecamp or Atlassian, that are large but also economically profitable. This is a good link to this New York Times article, which shows that there's a counter movement that's led by entrepreneurs who are jaded by the traditional playbook of blitzscaling and that are rejecting the model for more sane and profitable models. Now, the truth as usual is probably not a dichotomy. It's probably somewhere in the middle. And the goal of these companies a lot of the time is to reach IPO anyway. So from a founder's point of view, they're achieving their goal. Okay, enough with the theory and the reading. Let's dive into some tools that help you to see things like fundraising or revenue. Thanks to Jean for sharing this one. It's called unicornrepublic.co. It's a curated list of startups that evolved into 1 billion plus corporations. You can sort by newest and by valuations. And my favorite part is their map view. Of course, they are missing a few companies in there, but we'll be sure to let them know. We also fell in love with this functionality shared by Julia and offered by Dealroom. It allows you to see European investments, exits, new funds, and it's amazing to be able to target by country and cities, but also by industry and business models and even topics. I love this tool. In it, you can see that UK, Germany, and France lead the way in investments, while UK, Germany, and Sweden lead the way in exits. Bookmark this one and play around with it. On a similar note, this one was shared by Jean, and it focuses on revenue of companies. It lists some of 2018's fastest growing SaaS startups. You can segment by revenue range from 100K to 10 million. Pretty cool, check it out. And by the way, also from Jean, if you're looking for investors, angelmatch.io offers a big range of them. And what's nice is you can search for them based on what niche you're in. Okay, enough with the money talk, let's talk art, design, UX. Thanks to Jean again for sharing my new favorite addiction. It's called Zode and it allows you to see some design inspiration every time you open a new tab. The design inspiration comes from Dribbble, it's pure eye candy, and you can sort by color. And for some reason, I just can't seem to stop opening tabs. This one's also really, really cool. It's called lawsofux.com. It's a collection of the maxims and principles that designers can consider when building user interfaces. What's fantastic is that it's easy to digest. Here's my favorite one, and it's that users spend most of their time on other sites than yours. That means that users prefer your site to work the same way as all other sites that they already know. We call that reducing the cognitive overload, adapting your user interface to make it feel and look intuitive because it looks like the ones they usually use. Oh, by the way, speaking of free stuff, here are some free icons. It's called xicons.co and there's a new icon pack every 10 days. Speaking of free stuff, here's resourcecards.com. We've seen a bunch of these around the internet. Here's a new one. It's selected free resources for designers from fonts, icons, prototypes, colors, etc., etc. Go and check it out and try not to drown in the amount of resources. This one's just for fun and it's shared by Ferdinand if you have a few minutes to kill. It's called can'tunsee.space and basically what you do is you try to find which version of a design is the correct one and then you gain points. Okay, still on user experience, we've said this many, many times, we still think videos are more important than ever, but we know that there can be a barrier to actually creating your videos, so we've been trying to share tools and resources to help you make videos more easily. This is mixkit.co, it's a library of pretty awesome HD videos. And then for videos, you usually need music in the background. So here's a long list of royalty-free music for the background of your videos. And one of the hardest parts of video, of course, is editing and trimming. If you're having trouble getting your desktop videos ready for Facebook or Snapchat, this is a cool little trimmer and it's simple. Thanks to Stefan for sharing it. You basically upload a video, you trim, and you send to Facebook or Snapchat. It's not perfect, but it's pretty good for a minimal viable experiment. Still on video, here's a cool one shared by Peter. It's called 23.net. It helps marketing teams to integrate integrate and successfully run video on their website, sort of like Wistia or Vimeo. This one works across all channels with webinars and they track video data. Okay, last one about moving images. If you really have zero time to produce these images, here's Pixteller.com that allows you to create images that move with text in a matter of minutes. Okay, enough with the art and the videos, now let's talk security. We were reading this Wired article. It seems someone has cobbled together those breached databases and many more into a gargantuan, unprecedented collection of 2.2 billion unique usernames and associated passwords. And what's scary is it's freely being distributed on hacker forums and torrents. So it's throwing out the private data of a significant fraction of humanity, just like last year's phone book. Your passwords and your emails are out there being shared for free. So thanks to Paolo, here's a cool Chrome extension that helps with security and passwords. It allows to check if your passwords are compromised. You just install the Chrome extension and you use your passwords every day. And if there's a problem, you'll get this big fat red message to change your password. And still speaking of security, if you want to take security to the next level, here's a really nice checklist of things that you can do, from extremely easy, like using a password manager, to medium, like using a privacy-first web browser, to a little bit harder, like using encrypted messaging platforms. Okay, since we're talking black hat, we can talk a little bit about scraping, but ethical scraping. The playbook of the month goes to Thomas. Phantom Buster never ceases to amaze us. You can now easily scrape Slack channel users with Phantom Buster. And of course, since cold emailing is illegal, you can then easily find their LinkedIn profile, and then you can auto-add them and custom message them using useorca.com. UseOrca allows you to set up LinkedIn lifecycle messaging. So you're setting up outreach sequences, just like with email marketing, but on LinkedIn. And what's great is it also has a Zapier integration if you want to take automations to the next level. Speaking of reaching out to people, here's a cool one shared by Mirella for recruiters, or maybe called Outreach. It scrapes the web and creates a one-page CV with contact details and social media links, and it's free for up to 50 profiles per month. Test it out, let us know what you think. Okay, and speaking of LinkedIn, Jim shared this one. LinkedIn has a new ad format. We've usually seen that LinkedIn ads only work if you have a customer lifetime value or product with a customer lifetime value of 15,000 euros or more. I could be wrong in your case, but that's usually the best practice we follow. But having said that, check out their new format. It's called the Spotlight ad. And we're always excited when ad platforms come out with new formats. Okay, little avalanche of random tools now. I didn't know where these fit, so I'll just share them one by one. Our company is addicted to workflowy. Jim has found a similar tool that has a bit more functionality, Notion.so. He's been using this tool since a few weeks instead of workflowy, and he really likes it. This one's a cute one. It's shared by Jean. It's called typewritesomething.com, and that's exactly what it does. You type, and it sounds like a typewriter. This one's kind of an important one. We've been using it for 2 years, but we never mentioned it. It was mentioned again by Ferdinand. MonkeyLearn allows you to do some text analysis in your Google Sheets. So you can do sentiment analysis, topic modeling. It can help you get insights from large unstructured sets of data. If you want to tap into text mining and natural language processing, so basically AI with text, check it out. It does a really good job. Ferdinand also shared this one. It's an alternative to Alternative 2. So it lets you find alternatives to existing tools. Somebody in our network thought that MailChimp.com was becoming too expensive. So here are some alternatives that this tool found. The results are pretty good and you can use it as a complement to Alternative 2. Here's another cute one shared by Jean. The DVD background. For any of you who are old enough to know what I'm talking about, it's that DVD thing and you wait for it to hit the corner. It only works for Android, but I usually share tools that only work for Apple. So, you know, cut me some slack. Okay, and here's some more articles that we think you should read. This is a really interesting article from Bernardo about the fact that people are actually struggling to get into data science courses. And that's one of the reasons why we're currently building a data science traineeship. But more about that in the future. Here's a really nice article from Anadia about a new position in recruiting. It's called Rec Ops, and it sort of feels like the rise of the technical recruiter. Sebastian shared a really nice blog as well. It's Joanna Lord's blog. She's the new head of marketing at Skyscanner. She has a really cool take on the T-shaped marketeer and some really nice points of view on branding. It's really nice insights being shared by somebody who's actually in the trenches. Love this sort of alarmist article from Bernardo about Apple. Customers are willing to pay upwards of $1,000 for a phone, but only if they're rewarded with just as much status. Read the article and you'll understand some of the current psychological shortcomings of the brand. This one shared by Sebastian is also really nice. This use case actually segments product market fit. If you're looking into product market fit, once you start segmenting, you can actually uncover who your early adopters are. And then this one's also pretty cool. We found it on Bloomberg. Are you in the top 1% of highest earners of your country? This article shows what it takes financially to be in the top 1% of your country. It doesn't cover all countries, but you get an idea. So that's it. I hope you liked it. Please support us, like and subscribe, download the resources, and we'll see you really, really soon.